There was a conference themed regenerative medicine in Hong Kong in 2019, and I presented two topics, so I want to share the issues on my YouTube channel. In addition to futuristic subjects, they prepared a live demonstration of the PLP treatment for painful rooted cough tears in a complete surgical setting in an operation room. I want to express my sincere gratitude for the invitation. It remains unforgettable good memories. I think many of you could recognize these two celebrities. It is the title of hypertonic dextrose therapy in chronic MSK patients. I'll modify the previous lecture and add my clinical experiences. These photos demonstrate the clinical practice that I use 50% of dextrose solution with 4% lidocaine and intermittently blend with botulinum toxin. My protocol of dextrose solution is more hypertonic than other clinicians' one. I always undergo injection treatment under ultrasound guidance in a sterile condition. I know many prolotherapists still undergo palpation-based injection treatment. First, I'll review the opinion of advocates of prolotherapy. The dream of dextroprolotherapy is to regenerate and restore injured musculoskeletal structures. The Hackett Patterson Foundation is the leading worldwide group. They define the prolotherapy as a non-surgical, non-opioid treatment that stimulates the body's natural healing response to repair injured, painful joint, ligaments, and tendons. They put a hypertonic solution into the affected area to initiate healthy tissue growth to reduce pain, improve mobility, and restore function. They believe regenerative therapy effectively treats chronic pain for musculoskeletal injuries, arthritis, tendinitis, bursitis, and joint instability. What do I expect if I introduce dextrose solution into the biological tissue? First, I admit that I use 30% to 40% dextrose solution, nearly 2 milliosmol per liter. When I was young, I followed an authentic protocol such as 5 to 10% of dextrose solution. Thus, the dextrose solution is very hypertonic. It is the basic biological mechanism of the dextrose injection. Local administered hypertonic dextrose initiate a fluid extraction from the interstitial space. It will be succeeded by transferring fluid into the interstitial space with dextrose and extracting fluid from cells by the non-penetrating dextrose. It increases the permeability of capillaries, shrinks cells, and causes interstitial edema. Eventually, it causes a minor abnormal cellular environment. The provoked cellular environment at tendons and cartilage near bones produce an inflammatory response that turns on the healing process. As a result, the new ligament and tendons become thicker and more robust, containing fibers of varying thickness. Furthermore, it inhibits the pathologic angiogenesis and neural ingrowth, the leading cause of chronic MSK pain generation. According to their theory, prolotherapy should be a magic bullet for MSK disease. However, there are always gaps between ideals and reality. I conducted a study to evaluate the effect of 10% of dextrose in patients with torn rotator cuff 16 years ago. It was effective in relieving pain, but did not change the degree of tear during a period of a follow-up period. I assumed two causes of failure in regeneration. The first one is the retraction of the proximal tendon and gaps between two ends. It is a similar mechanism to the non-union of a fractured bone. I believe the healing process of fractured bone and torn tendon are same. Basic knowledge is that the prerequisite for healing the broken bone are adequate blood supply and mechanical stability. Without proper blood supply and mechanical stability, the interconnecting regeneration process is impossible in the rotator cuff tear. The dextrose or PLP stimulates the underlying fibroblast, but the fibroblast cannot jump to another site without continuity. The second one is the subacromial and joint fluid. The fluid is a lubricant created to protect surface layers from adhesion or reattachment of two ends. The lubricants would wash out the regenerating chemicals and interfere with the action of fibroblasts. The situation is very similar to the meniscus tear. I don't believe the dextrose or even PLP treatment cannot heal the torn meniscus. It is my assumption. Dextrose prolotherapy could work in mild tendon or ligament pathologies such as tennis elbow and plantar fasciitis. Dextrose prolotherapy has a limitation on the regeneration of largely torn tendons and torn structures adjacent to joint fluid. However, I believe it has a pain-reducing effect by an unknown mechanism. Let's review the basic scientific findings and clinical research on the dextrose effect on joint and soft tissue. An animal study shows how normal tendon would change if I infiltrate dextrose into the intra-tendon space. They infiltrate injections of either 5% dextrose or 20% of dextrose into the non-injured red Achilles tendon. They found that a single injection significantly increased tendon diameter and fibroblast compared to the non-injection site. The right dextrose injection site is thicker than the non-injected left tendon. 5% and 20% of dextrose injection show the thicker diameter than a saline injection or non-injection site. Anti-inflammatory drug administration did not affect the Achilles diameter and fibroblast account, suggesting a non-inflammatory mechanism of proliferation. What if I infiltrate the dextrose solution into the peri-tendon area? It is a more common situation than an intra-tendinous injection. They injected 10% of glucose solution into the synovium around the middle digit flexor tendon of a healthy rabbit. At 4 weeks after dextrose injection, the cellularity appears to increase further and the evidence of vascular proliferation was seen along the collagen remodeling. 8 weeks after dextrose injection, more angiogenesis and thicker collagen bundles were observed without inflammation. 12 weeks after dextrose injection, they observed the vascular proliferation and thicker collagen bundles in the tendon. How will change in the injured ligament if we put a dextrose solution into the injured ligaments? It is a typical indication of prolotherapy, and most prolotherapy usually make a target dextrose into the torn area. It was their hope dextrose injections would enlarge the cross-sectional area, decrease laxity, and strengthen and stiffen stretched injured medial collateral ligaments. Dextrose prolotherapy will increase collagen favorable diameter and density of stretched injured MCLs. However, there are always gaps between ideals and reality. After 5 weeks of injection, dextrose and saline injections did not alter laxity. Stiffness was not different after 2, 4, or 5 weeks of healing treatment. Few macrophages were found in the injured and injected ligaments 5 weeks after injury. MCL ligaments showed no significant difference in MCL strength or fibroblast number 3 weeks after injection with 15% of dextrose or saline, but the cross-sectional area was significantly increased in the dextrose injection MCLs. It is my brief illustration of torn fibers of the MCL. The dextrose did not heal the separation, but expanded the fibers by intervening in newly formed soft tissue. I applied the fact to my clinical treatment. Interfacial hydrodissection with dextrose solution will expand the tissue and provoke replacement by connective tissues. As instability is the leading cause of a cascade of degeneration, making the ligament thicker will decrease the chance of injury to the meniscus or other soft tissue and slow down the degenerative process. There are several human clinical studies about the benefits of dextrose injection. In a study of video arthroscopy documentation, dextrose may stimulate or mediate chondrogenesis. However, I don't expect much about the benefits of regeneration of denuded hyaline cartilage. In a clinical study of ligament or tendon proliferation, dextrose has benefits in clinical improvement, but there is no evidence of MRI or ultrasound changes. However, Achilles tendinosis and plantar fasciitis showed a fair result, as I expected. The dextrose solution has additional benefits if the rotator cuff pathology is insignificant. I use dextrose for its benefits for pain relief by an unknown mechanism. According to their study, blocking the TLPV1 receptors is the possible primary mechanism of pain reduction. It is my conclusion about dextrose prolotherapy. There are long-term clinical improvement in the tendon, ligament-related pain and some arthritic pain. Injection into normal tendon, ligament, or peri-tendon causes the tendon produces a ligament thickening or peritendinous proliferation. It is wise not to expect a healing process or tissue regeneration in the injured ligament or tendon. For example, suppose an oblique insertional tear of the extensor tendon in tennis elbow. In that case, it is better not to expect the healing process in the tear site because of the traction force in the proximal tendon, but rather target the adjacent healthy tendon, which will increase the thickness and stimulate fibroblast in the healthy region, which enforce the total tendon strength. Dextrose prolotherapy will relieve significant pain relief by an unknown mechanism. Thank you for watching. See you in the following videos.